Let us, therefore, brace ourselves to our duties, and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
Good evening, I'm Nicholas Hoare for Vermont PBS. In 1994, a young British historian by the name of Andrew Roberts published a book, which was very naughty at the time, blowing a hole in several acolytes, admirers, and general hangers-on to Sir Winston Churchill. And he called the book Eminent Churchillians. And his purpose was to blow a hole in the myths and legends attached to a clutch of individuals who thought they could, by the simple expedient of following Sir Winston, become, as it were, his nearest and dearest. Well, they didn't become anything of the sort. And this book was patterned very freely on an earlier book published in 1911, hence the title. That one was called Eminent Victorians by none other than Lytton Strachey. I have in my hand a very elegant little pocket edition of that. It's hardcover still, and I commend it to you warmly. It's a wonderful book, and it really blows a hole in several really elegant Victorian figures. Well, this book did much the same thing in 1994. It was a succes to Scandale. It did extremely well, and it's gone down as a classic of its type. Take that same Andrew Roberts 25 years later, and he's gone one step further. And this time, he's written about the man himself. And has he ever? This book is called Churchill, Walking with Destiny. It was published in 2018 to international acclaim. It is nothing less than a masterpiece. And while I could be accused of singing the praise of a book whose topic has been written about hundreds, if not thousands, of times before, the fact remains that this one book has, in its 1,100 pages, put into print almost everything that's come out in the years since its predecessor was published. Now, what was that predecessor, and why is its newcomer so important by comparison? Well, Sir Roy Jenkins published an equally elegant book on Churchill, not quite as long, but very close to it, in 2004. And that was called simply, Churchill, a Biography. And it was written by an insider himself, Roy Jenkins being obviously, or having been, a very much respected British politician. And at the time, it too received immense acclaim, and it too was a raging bestseller. But in the time between this and that, public archives have released a mass of material that simply wasn't available to the late lamented Roy Jenkins. But it was available to Andrew Roberts. And that material has been the icing on his historical cake, making the book a monument. This is not the sort of thing that you will read in an evening, nor in a month. It's taken me a long time since it was first published last fall to really get to the end of it. But if you do it in good, sharp doses, you are likely to be treated to an extraordinary mix of social history, political history, British history, travel, the whole ball of wax attached to this immensely complex and fascinating man. It's impeccably written, and I'm just going to take a couple of snippets to give you a taste of what you're up to. This is set in 1942, and the passage reads simply, Sunday, the 7th of December, 41, the Japanese attacked the U.S. Navy base at Pearl Harbor in Hawaii, sinking or seriously damaging 7 of the 8 battleships stationed in the port. Over the coming days, Japan launched invasions of Malaya, the Philippines, Borneo, Thailand, Hong Kong, and the Dutch East Indies. Churchill was at Chequers giving a dinner to celebrate Kathleen Harriman's 24th birthday. As they were finishing, a radio was brought into the dining room by Frank Sawyer so that Churchill and his guests could listen to the BBC 9 o'clock news, a regular practice. In a spectacularly bad piece of news editing, the fact that the Japanese had attacked American ships in Hawaii came towards the end of the broadcast.
Here is the news. Japan's long-threatened aggression in the Far East began tonight with air attacks on United States naval bases in the Pacific. Fresh reports are coming in every minute. The latest facts of the situation are these. Messages from Tokyo say that Japan has announced a formal declaration of war against both the United States and Britain.
Churchill immediately went to his study to telephone Roosevelt. Mr. President, what's this about Japan? He asked. They've attacked us at Pearl Harbor, Roosevelt replied. We're all in the same boat now. Churchill goes to Washington for 3 weeks. He befriends Roosevelt to such an extent that the two gentlemen wandered in and out of each other's bedrooms freely, sporting their pajamas, as though they were intimate friends. They weren't, of course, but they became very friendly. And the next passage concerns this. Of the Renault cabinet, the French cabinet, Churchill said, "When I warned them that Britain would fight on alone, whatever they did, their generals told their prime minister and his divided cabinet, in 3 weeks, England will have her neck wrung like a chicken. Some chicken, some neck." Immediately after the speech, Churchill was led into the Speaker's chamber of the Canadian House of Parliament by Mackenzie King, where the young Armenian-Canadian photographer Karsh was waiting to take his picture. He seemed reluctant, as he'd not been warned that this would happen, but conceded that Karsh could take one photograph. I offered him an ashtray for his cigar, but he pointedly ignored it, his eyes boring into mine, Karsh recalled. At the camera, I made sure everything was in focus, closed the lens, and stood up, my hand ready to close the shutter release, when something made me hesitate. Karsh then said, "Forgive me, sir," and without permission removed the cigar from Churchill's mouth. His jaw tightened in belligerence, his eyes blazed, and I clicked the shutter. The result was the greatest of all the thousands of images of Churchill, capturing his resolution, defiance, and solidity, and, as Karsh noted, also his capacity for belligerence. It was not the only photo of Churchill taken by Karsh that day, but it is the one that fully deserves the overworked adjective iconic. It was the cover of Life magazine in May 45 and became the defining image of him and can still be seen on the dust jacket of this book. Now, before we conclude, I would like to give you an illustration of the cross-sectional view of how many books have come out about Churchill and about his connections and about his house, the legendary Chartwell, and about his tribe. And of course, the Dukes of Marlborough on their own merit books. We have here The Churchill Factor, written by none other than Boris Johnson, who of course is the gentleman deeply involved in the Brexit situation as we speak. We have Lloyd George's connection to Churchill, which of course was a love-hate one. We have The Family Itself, The Churchills in Love and War by Mary Lovell. And we also have a delightful, slightly off the wall book called Churchill and Chartwell about the house, the garden, and his Nibs's wonderful propensity for painting. So all to say that if you want to have all this and then some popped into the pages of an 1100 page whopper with, I might say, almost 150 pages of references at the back in case you wish to pursue him further, you need go no further. This is a monument of its type. It's an absolute classic. And I must say, I have read a few Churchill books in my time, but this one beats the pants off the lot. And on that Churchillian note, good evening.
We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets, we shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.